Walk the ancient paths of glory, avenues of bloody conquest which ensnared the world in a web of power and turned an insignificant city into ruler over most of the known world. Road building is one of the great indicators of a successful civilization. A society must have long-term success to invest the time, manpower, and money to build an infrastructure designed to last. It's not that the Romans were the first to build highways and byways of any significance. The Greeks and the Persians did, and so did the Etruscans, the civilization that predates the Romans in Italy. But no one before them had built with the long-term planning, precision, and scope of those the Roman Empire left behind. The first great Roman roads were begun in the 4th century BC. They were still building them in the far reaches of the empire as late as the 4th century AD. So in total, Roman road building stretched over 8 centuries. The major objective was to ensure that no major point anywhere in the empire was isolated.
So the road system developed with major arteries running from major towns on 3 continents, Europe, the Near East, that is Asia, and North Africa. Not all of these were paved. Popular conception is that they were paved with stone. The lesser ones would tend to be tracks, but kept up, that is to say, raked over or whatever. The technical word is metalled, that is, they'd have gravel and crushed stone on them. The main roads would be blocks of stone carefully fitted together and very carefully built.
It is generally accepted that the first of the great paved Roman highways to be built was the Via Appia.
Here is one of the relatively well-preserved segments of the Via Appia Antica. The name Appia comes from the name of the censor, Appius Claudius Caecus, Appius Claudius the Blind, who built the thing, or started the thing, in 312 BC. The road was the first one to extend the Roman road system really outside of the area immediately around the city. The ultimate aim of the road was to take Roman troops from here down to the ancient city of Capua near the modern city of Naples.
Appius had convinced the Senate this project warranted their approval. He then oversaw the massive undertaking of building a thoroughfare to Capua, the place where the Roman legions had recently defeated the Samnites, a distance of 132 miles. The paving stones were quarried from a deposit of silex lava. They were cut, shaped, polished, and fitted so closely together that a knife blade often couldn't fit in between them. The roadbed was 15 feet across and only widened near the gates of the city to accommodate more pedestrian traffic. As sections were completed, Appius had trees planted along the route to give shade to the travelers soon to come. Gently rolling land just south of Rome made the first several miles of construction easy. Then it had to pass through the swampy lowlands known as the Pontine Marshes. Construction literally bogged down as malaria plagued the work crews as they built a 6-foot-high causeway above the flatlands so the Appia would stay high and dry. Where the water got too deep, a short boat ride became necessary. It was several hundred years later, during the reign of the Emperor Trajan, that the marshes were partially drained and travel on the Appia was no longer interrupted. As construction continued, Appius lost his sight and became known as Appius the Blind. Legend has it that Appius continued to oversee the building and care of his road. He would walk along the Appia barefoot and was able to feel the joints of the stones with his feet to determine if they'd been correctly fitted and maintained. Appius died before his magnificent via made it all the way to Capua. His family built a large tomb along the road that bore his name. This was the beginning of another trend. Over the years, many miles of the Appia became crowded with cemeteries, tombs, and other funerary structures. It was law and tradition to bury the dead outside the city, in places that people would travel. It was not only a tribute, but also a reminder to all who passed by that they too were mortal. The Appian Way was the only road of its kind for some time. It was later extended to the port of Brindisi on the east coast of Italy and had a total length of 350 miles. During this time, other great roads began to radiate out from Rome and lace the Italian peninsula. They also began to spread across most of the known world. It wasn't too long before, at the height of the empire, all roads would indeed seem to lead to Rome. Roads were essential to all governmental and cultural enterprises. And the Roman Empire, being vast, required an extensive road system. As with modern cultures, most of the cost of building infrastructure was paid for out of revenues collected as taxes and tariffs. Most of the emperors understood just how critical these avenues of transportation and communication were. Some, like the first emperor, Augustus, actually contributed significant portions of their personal fortunes to road construction or refurbishment. They encouraged other rich men to do so as well. Since the roads themselves were deemed important to the empire, to be in charge of their repair and administration was considered an esteemed position. The Roman road system was divided up into several districts. Each district had a curator who was responsible for the maintenance in his area.
This meant the obvious, which is, of course, replacing loose stones with great care to drainage and the like. Make sure the milestones are not carted off to build somebody's house, to keep the curbs, which were built on the best roads, in line. Those get battered by animals, carriage wheels, and all these things had to be taken care of. And of course, if there was an earthquake, and there's a great line of earthquakes, as we all know, that runs right across Turkey, Greece, Yugoslavia, and into Italy and beyond. If there was a great flood or natural disaster, the curator of that section had his work cut out for him because the roads had to be kept in repair.
Julius Caesar's rise to power began because of the praise he received while he held the position of overseer for the Appian Way. Later, as a general and then the ruler of Rome, the roads served him well. Most of the main roads throughout the empire were started for military purposes. As more and more territory came under Roman rule, they became critical lines of communications for news and orders. They greatly increased the speed of armies dispatched to any trouble spot within the empire, or to the fortifications built along its frontiers. When traveling, the legions would usually march six abreast. One can only imagine what an imposing sight the mobile Roman army must have been. All civilian traffic obviously gave them the right of way. Besides the throngs of infantry, there might be mounted horses. Huge weapons of war, including catapults and battering rams pulled on wooden wheeled carts, added to what must have been a thundering rumble. Food, water, and other supplies would also accompany an army on the move. At the end of each day, they would build an encampment to spend the night. Often, these encampments would be turned into outposts to house a small number of soldiers. Their responsibilities included policing the area to keep highwaymen and brigands from preying on passing travelers. In the eyes of some emperors, the building of the roads served a purpose beyond the obvious military and economic ones. Public works construction kept the army busy between wars. Busy hands are happy hands, and idleness is the devil's playground are two axioms that the rulers of Rome would have understood well. digging ditches, laying paving, and building other Roman infrastructure would hopefully keep the questioning of authority and rebellion to a minimum. While the army did provide almost all of the manual labor for road construction outside of Italy, closer to Rome, civilian, criminal, and slave labor did much of the backbreaking work.
The degree to which slaves were used in making roads is very difficult to determine. Road administration was in the hands of men known as curatores, curators. And they varied in their authority and the district which they were in charge of. And they would be allowed to hire slave gangs, freedmen and the like, and ordinary citizens to work. It's awfully difficult unless we have a description in, say, a written passage of literature or an inscription to say anything about this. But we do know that free people and slaves often worked side by side. And the government owned slave gangs in Rome that may have in other places. Slavery diminished as the empire's life was prolonged. No new conquests, no new slaves.
Rome was filled with skilled architects, engineers, and surveyors who helped plan and build the great structures we associate with the Roman Empire. The building of a road was planned and executed with the same care and effort that went into the Colosseums, arches, and aqueducts. In Roman times, a surveyor had relatively simple instruments to work with. The compass had not yet been invented, so a sundial was used to determine direction. A groma was a device made up of two perpendicular sticks with hanging plumb bobs on the top of a staff. It helped lay out straight and level routes. Actual construction usually began with the digging of ditches on both sides of the planned road to drain away any excess water. Preparation of a foundation was the innovative step that set Roman highway building apart from anything attempted before. A trench was dug down to a layer of rock or clay, then was filled with layers of sand, small rocks, and possibly concrete. The climate and the type of soil determined how elaborate the foundation had to be in any given area. Finally, the paving and curbstones that had been cut and shaped by skilled stonemasons were fitted together with great precision. The roads were designed to be a little higher in the middle, so the rainwater would run off to the sides. The fact that this work was done with basic hammers, chisels, picks, and spades makes it clear how much manpower must have been expended. The removal of excess dirt was done in basket loads. The wheelbarrow, already in use in China, was not yet part of European technology. The impressive end result of all this planning and labor did not go unappreciated. The Greek author and philosopher Plutarch had this to say in around 120 BC.
The roads were carried straight across the countryside without deviation, were paved with hewn stones and bolstered underneath with masses of tight-packed sand. Hollows were filled in. Torrents or ravines that cut across the route were bridged. The sides kept parallel and on the same level. All in all, the work presented a vision of smoothness and beauty.
The bridges that were built across the rivers and ravines are further testimony of the engineering skill and advanced building techniques of the Romans. One method the Romans employed on some of the larger bridges over water was to use a series of barges to create an initial foundation and work platform. Early on, the Senate was concerned about the reliability of some of the proposed bridges. In the case of the Ponte Fabricio, payment was withheld for 40 years to make sure of its durability. The Senate's concerns turned out to be unwarranted. The Ponte Fabricio is still in use today, some 2,000 years after it first spanned the Tiber. Historians are not fully certain when the Romans decided to traverse the Alps, but it was probably motivated by their determination to subdue the Gauls. Three roads had been built to the base of the Alps. The St. Bernard Pass, 8,111 feet above sea level, was chosen as the place to cross. It was decided that the environment might be too cold for slaves, so soldiers did the work. Once completed, the snowfall was often so heavy during Roman winters that the pass was closed from November to April. At the highest point in the pass, a temple was built, along with a rest station that also housed men assigned to rescue travelers lost in the snow. Road building in the different territories of the expanding empire often presented challenges to the construction crews that were formidable, but never insurmountable. For example, construction in Spain was problematic. It was mountainous, suffered from bad weather, and was infested with bandits. But Spain's wealth of raw materials and precious metals made it worth the effort. According to Plutarch, the decision to mark all the main roads with milestones was made around 120 BC. The Roman mile was based on 1,000 military paces, which comes to around 4,800 feet, a little shorter than today's mile. The milestone was made to have an average height of about 7 feet and weighed around 1,000 pounds. The information carved into it usually included the name of the road, the mileage, and the name of the emperor in whose reign the road was built or renovated. One reason for the decision to place milestones along the roads may have been to create a public works program. Slaves had taken work away from the underclass, and unemployment and crime were becoming problems in Rome. Thousands of milestones were quarried, carved, and hauled all over the empire.
In a sense, of course, it's not that all roads lead to Rome, it's that all these roads lead from Rome. Roads led from Rome in order to control Rome's empire. And the golden milestone, which was erected by the Emperor Augustus in 20 BC, was a great, huge, in fact, not made out of gold at all, but marble milestone with the distances in bronze plaques to the great cities of the empire from that spot. It was just under the Temple of Saturn.
Part of the reason that Augustus chose this part of the city, and particularly this part of the Forum to erect the milestone, was that it's the political center of the Forum. This was the part of the Forum where the Senate negotiated decisions of war and peace, where all the laws were made and passed. And so it made sense in that way to have the center of the Roman world be there. But in a sense, it's metaphorical. The roads don't really converge in the center of Rome. They converge only at the gates, so they converge at the wall. But for Augustus, Rome had become a capital city of an empire, and he needed for his political agenda a physical center, a metaphorical center.
We will never know exactly what was inscribed on the golden milestone. It disappeared shortly after the fall of the empire, probably ravaged for its bronze plaques, which could be removed and melted down. Roman roads were often dedicated and named in honor of the powerful emperors of Rome. Even though they were important militarily, they were built for everybody to use.
Ordinary people used the roads, like the rest of us, for religious purposes, seeing temples, visiting oracles, going to Athens for a bit of education. But, of course, the way that the roads penetrated furthest into ordinary people's lives were that they brought products from all over the empire to Rome. The roads connected Rome to India and the spice trade. And the grain that went into the bread that people ate wasn't grown next door. It came by sea from Africa and Egypt, but then up the roads to Rome. There's a customs tariff from Africa, which shows all the things that traveled along these roads, everything from fish paste, garum, to slaves coming up from the Sahara Desert, to horses, mules, animals, cloth, purple dye. Anything that you could buy was likely to have traveled along one of the great roads.
At its peak, Rome had over 1 million citizens, and it had to be constantly supplied by the local farmers. On an average day in the first century AD, chariots here would have been a much rarer sight than farmers taking their goods to market. The curious thing is that with all the effort in building and maintaining a magnificent road system, it was not the best way to transport bulk goods. The Romans never perfected a type of harness that enabled horses to pull heavy carts or wagons. They were originally designed for slow-moving oxen and would press on a horse's windpipe when pulling a heavy load or going uphill. Of course, when possible, the more practical way to transport goods was by water. Boats were often much faster, thus much less expensive. It was only the Romans' fear and suspicion of the sea that kept shipping from becoming the main method of transport to far-off destinations. One of the most interesting commodities being shipped along the roads was the astounding menagerie of wild animals then being captured all over the Roman world. Some became pets or parts of collections of the rich and powerful. A majority of these exotic species ended up in the spectacles being staged at the Roman amphitheaters. Sometimes, hunts would be reenacted. Often, different species would be pitted against each other. Many times, it was man against beast in a battle to the death. The death penalty for criminals was often carried out by ravenous animals for the entertainment of the spectators. Christians suffered the same fate during the period of the Great Persecutions. The Emperor Claudius had a division of Praetorian Guards battle panthers. During Nero's reign, 400 tigers faced off against bulls and elephants in one day. 5,000 animals lost their lives as part of the Colosseum's opening ceremonies. The streets of Rome are prone to traffic jams today, and the same was true during the height of the Empire's success. Noisy crowds combined with the deafening sound of wooden wheels clattering over pavement stones. More than once, laws were passed forbidding, or at least limiting, daytime traffic within the city. After the disastrous rule of Nero and the three emperors that came and went within a year, Vespasian's 10-year rule helped reorganize an empire in disarray. New roads were built in Asia and Spain. He then commissioned the overseer of the roads to make a survey of the entire highway system, from which many maps called itinerarii were made. A specific itinerarium would show the route between cities, mileage, rest stops, and other details helpful to travelers.
The most interesting is the pointer table. It's a medieval copy of a much earlier Roman map. And it's called the pointer table because it was acquired by Conrad Pointer in 1508. It's now preserved in Vienna. And it's an extremely interesting map because when you first look at it, it doesn't look like anything we recognize as a map. And what it is it's a graphic picture of routes. It's how to get from A to B in a very abstract way. The best parallel are maps of subway systems. It gives us straight lines running, say, from Carthage to the great legionary fortress at Lambyses, with along it marked all the stops that are possible along the way, so that it was like a guidebook.
A common sight along the roads just outside of Rome was the funeral procession. Funerals were grand occasions for the wealthier families. Professional mourners filled out some of the processions. Actors wearing death masks would portray ancestral family members. The body of the deceased was placed on a bed or a couch-like litter. Candles and torches often were burning at each corner. Pine cones and incense were also burned, possibly to hide the odor of the corpse that usually had laid in state at home for up to a week. Early on, most of the funerals were cremations. Later, interment became more popular. For the elite, size of funerals and tombs clearly became a case of status-seeking one-upsmanship. But such competition was considered inappropriate, and laws were passed to restrict the number of professional mourners allowed in a procession. Family members would visit their interment sites. Pagan Romans believed that the recently deceased still needed to be nourished with food and drink. But the most impressive spectacles to happen on the roads of Rome were grand processions called triumphs.
When a general concluded a major war and came back to the city of Rome with his army, he would wait outside the sacred boundary of the city, the Pomerium, and he would get permission from the Senate to enter the city. And when he did it with his entire army, with all the prisoners he took in the war, with all the spoils, and they would follow a certain prescribed route through the Campus Martius, starting at the Circus Flaminius, through the Circus Maximus, and then they would come down the Sacra Via, through the Forum, and then up onto the Capitoline Hill to the Temple of Jupiter.
These grand processions took on truly epic proportions. There would be trumpeters, and sometimes there would be floats representing captured cities. Mounted artwork would show scenes of the battles and heroic exploits of the returning heroes. Julius Caesar had one after each of his major conquests, each more lavish than the last. His final triumph lasted for 4 days. It would have seemed absolutely impossible to cheering throngs filled with imperial pride that assassination and civil war were just around the corner. Common language and currency throughout the empire made travel on the roads easy in some ways, but actually to journey any distance on them made for a long and arduous trip.
Traveling along roads would have been uncomfortable whoever you were, but I think the more money you had, the less uncomfortable it was. If we drive along the Appia today with modern suspension, it's still a very bumpy road. And so traveling in a carriage with no springs would have been pure hell. I think most people preferred to walk. A horse would have been a horse. But the emperors preferred to travel generally on litters. Those are sort of beds on poles, open if they wanted to show off, closed if they wanted to sleep. And they would have been carried by 8 bearers, and it would have been slow, but it would have been, I suppose, the most comfortable way of traveling of all.
Inns sprang up all over the main highways because overnight stopovers were usually required on anything but the shortest trips.
The inn by the side of the road would be where there was good water. It might be the simplest, crudest imaginable place with bad wine. The next step up would be a place with better cuisine, better wine, girls for rent, for example, it's very commonly spoken of. And some places, of course, were more elaborate, and these would be the mansiones, the mansions where government officials could stay overnight. You took your chances on the road. It was rough, it could be dangerous, and the kinds of accommodations one got were very iffy in many cases.
Though many inns were raw and Spartan, they were often the beginnings of a settlement. They would begin to grow with the additions of blacksmiths, wine merchants, horse doctors, and others offering service for passing travelers. Many of the great cities of Europe, like Vienna, Cologne, and Budapest, began as lowly stops on a Roman road. From his writings, we know that the great Roman poet Horace spent time on the roads. He had traveled on the Via Appia as a boy with his father to study with a learned Greek grammarian. As an adult, he also used the Appia and gives us an idea what travel was like back then in these excerpts from his satire titled From Rome to Brindisi with Stops.
It was a long journey lay before us. First at Aricia, we alight and there refresh and pass the night. Our entertainment? Rather coarse, but believe me, I've met with worse. From Aricia, we pushed on to Forum Appii, a place jammed with boatmen and sharp innkeepers. This 40 miles took us 2 days, while brisker travelers make it in one. At Forum Appii, I found the water so foul, I sturdily resolved to pronounce a fast, and in a moody humor wait, while my less dainty comrades ate.
Later, Horace tells of a stop at a farmhouse in the country and reveals a bawdier appetite, often celebrated in Roman literature and performance.
Here, like a fool, I was tricked by a girl who said she'd come and retire. I waited till midnight, but then sleep overcame my desire. Filled with pique at her cheek of such a flagrant nocturnal omission, I then contented myself with dreams composed of improper positions.
Horace describes other travails like traffic jams and mosquitoes, but bad food seemed to be his main complaint. At one point on his journey, he offered a piece of advice.
From hence in chaises we were carried 24 miles to town with many a sign. Their bread is deemed such a dainty fare that every prudent traveler loads with many crusts. For at Canesium, you might as well attempt to gnaw on a stone as to try and get just one morsel down.
Some emperors spent a great deal of time on the road. Claudius had a specially designed carriage that allowed him to indulge his passion for gambling. But it was Hadrian who spent more than half of his 21-year reign traveling to many of the farthest reaches of the empire. Hadrian suffered a tragedy during his travels. His young male companion, Antinous, drowned in the Nile. Hadrian paid homage to him by building an Egyptian city in his name. During the reign of Hadrian, the last of the great road-building emperors, the Roman Empire reached its widest boundaries. It was an age of peace and prosperity. It was a high point that had nowhere to go but into a decline that would bring the roads and the empire itself to a crashing fall. The Roman road system was designed to help the empire prosper. But the roads turned out to be a military liability as well as the asset they were originally meant to be.
It was convenient for barbarians to find their route paved out straight to Rome. It became particularly so in the later empire when the Goths would come down the Via Aurelia or Via Flaminia to Rome. But Hannibal, much earlier on, used the Via Latina for a lot of his activity in Italy. It was a two-way street road.
In 218 BC, during the Second Punic War, the Carthaginian general Hannibal left Spain on his prolonged siege against Rome. He led the first large army over the Alps into Italy, and for the next 15 years successfully waged war against every Roman legion sent to defeat him. Hannibal left a path of destroyed cities and bridges and a huge Roman death toll. Roman manpower was so consumed in warfare that no new Roman roads were built during this period. But road maintenance remained a priority. They had become economic and supply lifelines that had to be kept open. After 25 years of warfare, Rome had lost 500,000 men in battle. It was then Publius Scipio's turn to take command. He decided to no longer fight a defensive war and took the risk of striking at Carthage itself. In 204 BC, Scipio and an army of 25,000 men landed near Carthage. Hearing of the invasion, Hannibal headed back to North Africa. The Roman legions were far more skillful than Hannibal's war machine. Hannibal's army was soon outflanked. Victorious, Scipio took Hannibal's mother's name and became Scipio Africanus. Usually, after a victory, Roman roads would soon follow. But it was felt that Carthage was still dangerous. It wasn't until much later, when the city was literally leveled and then rebuilt under Roman rule, that it would have the advantage of being part of the great highway system. Not all resistance came from those fighting to keep from being absorbed into the empire. Sometimes rebellion came from within, from those tired of living under oppression.
The most famous of several slave revolts in the Roman world took place just before the establishment of the empire, in the 70s of the century before the Christian era, and led by a slave named Spartacus, who seems to have been both intelligent and humane. He rapidly gained many followers when he started this revolt, and he and his followers moved from southern Italy all the way up to northern Italy, to the Alps, but his followers wouldn't go any further. They wanted to plunder.
Spartacus used the roads to his advantage during the rebellion, but they also aided the legions dispatched to crush the insurrection. Finally, after Spartacus was cornered, the roads became the setting for the horrible punishment that he and his followers suffered at the hands of their oppressors. 6,000 slaves were crucified along the roadside as a graphic example of the terrible consequences of defiance. There was one revolution that almighty Rome was unable to suppress. It was a revolution of ideas in the form of a new religion, Christianity. The roads played an important part in Rome's attempts to stamp it out. But even under the constant threat of persecution and death by the empire, the followers of Jesus used the pagan highways to spread the words of their leader.
The most famous of all, of course, is St. Peter, who, having chosen to leave Rome to avoid a certain fate in the first great persecution, is said to have met Christ on the Appia, just outside of Rome, and when he asked Christ where Christ was going, Christ replied, to Rome to be crucified again. And at that point, St. Peter realized that he had to return to Rome and suffer the fate that, in fact, did await him.
The empire was never able to stop the spread of Christianity. For almost 300 years, it tried. But finally, in the year 312, Constantine became Rome's first Christian emperor. While paganism did not die out completely, Christianity was the official state religion.
There were a number of pilgrimages recorded to the Holy Land in the 300s and 400s of the Christian era. As soon as the Roman Emperor Constantine's mother went to Jerusalem and, according to legend, found the tomb of Christ and various instruments of the Passion, people wanted to go and see the very place where Scripture said Jesus had trod, preached, healed, and so forth. Since pilgrimages became common, then we draw properly the inference that the road system was in use by the pilgrims, probably to a considerable degree.
Despite Constantine's successful period of rule, the empire soon began its next stages of decline. First, Rome lost its grip on the conquered territories outside of Italy. Then, Italy itself broke up into several independent states. This upheaval signaled the end of greatness for the road system as well. During this era, there was not enough money for maintenance, and the beautiful paving stones were often pried up, used as building blocks for feudal castles and fortresses. Most of the tombs and other structures along roads like the Appia were plundered for building materials. Over the centuries, others fell into disrepair and became hideouts for bandits. In the Dark Ages, knowledge of the once great Roman Empire was all but lost, and the remnants of the great Roman roads in Europe were often believed to be the work of giants, demons, or the black arts. During the Renaissance, some influential artists, including Michelangelo, made unsuccessful appeals to save the Appia. It wasn't until the mid-1800s that any attempt was made to preserve what was left of it. Today, the old highways still hold up under modern traffic near Rome. After 2,000 years, portions of the old Roman road spanning three continents remain amazingly well preserved. Yet perhaps it's not so amazing. These roads, after all, were built by people convinced that their empire would last forever. It is a vivid lesson in determination that we can only learn by going in search of history. Walk the ancient paths of glory, avenues of bloody conquest which ensnared the world in a web of power and turned an insignificant city into ruler over most of the known world. Road building is one of the great indicators of a successful civilization. A society must have long-term success to invest the time, manpower, and money to build an infrastructure designed to last. It's not that the Romans were the first to build highways and byways of any significance. The Greeks and the Persians did, and so did the Etruscans, the civilization that predates the Romans in Italy. But no one before them had built with the long-term planning, precision, and scope of those the Roman Empire left behind. The first great Roman roads were begun in the 4th century BC. They were still building them in the far reaches of the empire as late as the 4th century AD. So in total, Roman road building stretched over 8 centuries. The major objective was to ensure that no major point anywhere in the empire was isolated.
So the road system developed with major arteries running from major towns on three continents, Europe, the Near East, that is Asia, and North Africa. Not all of these were paved. Popular conception is that they were paved with stone. The lesser ones would tend to be tracks, but kept up, that is to say, raked over or whatever. The technical word is metalled, that is, they'd have gravel and crushed stone on them. The main roads would be blocks of stone carefully fitted together and very carefully built.
It is generally accepted that the first of the great paved Roman highways to be built was the Via Appia.
Here is one of the relatively well-preserved segments of the Via Appia Antica. The name Appia comes from the name of the censor Appius Claudius Caecus, Appius Claudius the Blind, who built the thing or started the thing in 312 BC. The road was the first one to extend the Roman road system really outside of the area immediately around the city. The ultimate aim of the road was to take Roman troops from here down to the ancient city of Capua near the modern city of Naples.
Appius had convinced the Senate this project warranted their approval. He then oversaw the massive undertaking of building a thoroughfare to Capua, the place where the Roman legions had recently defeated the Samnites, a distance of 132 miles. The paving stones were quarried from a deposit of silex lava. They were cut, shaped, polished, and fitted so closely together that a knife blade often couldn't fit in between them. The roadbed was 15 feet across and only widened near the gates of the city to accommodate more pedestrian traffic. As sections were completed, Appius had trees planted along the route to give shade to the travelers soon to come. Gently rolling land just south of Rome made the first several miles of construction easy. Then it had to pass through the swampy lowlands known as the Pontine Marshes. Construction literally bogged down as malaria plagued the work crews as they built a 6-foot-high causeway above the flatlands so the Appia would stay high and dry. Where the water got too deep, a short boat ride became necessary. It was several hundred years later, during the reign of the Emperor Trajan, that the marshes were partially drained and travel on the Appia was no longer interrupted. As construction continued, Appius lost his sight and became known as Appius the Blind. Legend has it that Appius continued to oversee the building and care of his road. He would walk along the Appia barefoot and was able to feel the joints of the stones with his feet to determine if they'd been correctly fitted and maintained. Appius died before his magnificent via made it all the way to Capua. His family built a large tomb along the road that bore his name. This was the beginning of another trend. Over the years, many miles of the Appia became crowded with cemeteries, tombs, and other funerary structures. It was law and tradition to bury the dead outside the city, in places that people would travel. It was not only a tribute, but also a reminder to all who passed by that they too were mortal. The Appian Way was the only road of its kind for some time. It was later extended to the port of Brindisi on the east coast of Italy and had a total length of 350 miles. During this time, other great roads began to radiate out from Rome and lace the Italian peninsula. They also began to spread across most of the known world. It wasn't too long before, at the height of the empire, all roads would indeed seem to lead to Rome. Roads were essential to all governmental and cultural enterprises. And the Roman Empire, being vast, required an extensive road system. As with modern cultures, most of the cost of building infrastructure was paid for out of revenues collected as taxes and tariffs. Most of the emperors understood just how critical these avenues of transportation and communication were. Some, like the first emperor, Augustus, actually contributed significant portions of their personal fortunes to road construction or refurbishment. They encouraged other rich men to do so as well. Since the roads themselves were deemed important to the empire, to be in charge of their repair and administration was considered an esteemed position. The Roman road system was divided up into several districts. Each district had a curator who was responsible for the maintenance in his area.
This meant the obvious, which is, of course, replacing loose stones with great care to drainage and the like. Make sure the milestones are not carted off to build somebody's house, to keep the curbs, which were built on the best roads, in line. Those get battered by animals, carriage wheels, and all these things had to be taken care of. And of course, if there was an earthquake, and there's a great line of earthquakes, as we all know, that runs right across Turkey, Greece, Yugoslavia, and into Italy and beyond. If there was a great flood or natural disaster, the curator of that section had his work cut out for him because the roads had to be kept in repair.
Julius Caesar's rise to power began because of the praise he received while he held the position of overseer for the Appian Way. Later, as a general and then the ruler of Rome, the roads served him well. Most of the main roads throughout the empire were started for military purposes. As more and more territory came under Roman rule, they became critical lines of communications for news and orders. They greatly increased the speed of armies dispatched to any trouble spot within the empire, or to the fortifications built along its frontiers. When traveling, the legions would usually march six abreast. One can only imagine what an imposing sight the mobile Roman army must have been. All civilian traffic obviously gave them the right of way. Besides the throngs of infantry, there might be mounted horses. Huge weapons of war, including catapults and battering rams pulled on wooden wheeled carts, added to what must have been a thundering rumble. Food, water, and other supplies would also accompany an army on the move. At the end of each day, they would build an encampment to spend the night. Often, these encampments would be turned into outposts to house a small number of soldiers. Their responsibilities included policing the area to keep highwaymen and brigands from preying on passing travelers. In the eyes of some emperors, the building of the roads served a purpose beyond the obvious military and economic ones. Public works construction kept the army busy between wars. Busy hands are happy hands, and idleness is the devil's playground are two axioms that the rulers of Rome would have understood well. Digging ditches, laying paving, and building other Roman infrastructure would hopefully keep the questioning of authority and rebellion to a minimum. While the army did provide almost all of the manual labor for road construction outside of Italy, closer to Rome, civilian, criminal, and slave labor did much of the backbreaking work.
The degree to which slaves were used in making roads is very difficult to determine. Road administration was in the hands of men known as curatores, curators. And they varied in their authority and the district which they were in charge of. And they would be allowed to hire slave gangs, freedmen and the like, and ordinary citizens to work. It's awfully difficult unless we have a description in, say, a written passage of literature or an inscription to say anything about this. But we do know that free people and slaves often worked side by side. And the government owned slave gangs in Rome that may have in other places. Slavery diminished as the empire's life was prolonged. No new conquests, no new slaves.
Rome was filled with skilled architects, engineers, and surveyors who helped plan and build the great structures we associate with the Roman Empire. The building of a road was planned and executed with the same care and effort that went into the Colosseums, arches, and aqueducts. In Roman times, a surveyor had relatively simple instruments to work with. The compass had not yet been invented, so a sundial was used to determine direction. A groma was a device made up of two perpendicular sticks with hanging plumb bobs on the top of a staff. it helped lay out straight and level routes. Actual construction usually began with the digging of ditches on both sides of the planned road to drain away any excess water. Preparation of a foundation was the innovative step that set Roman highway building apart from anything attempted before. A trench was dug down to a layer of rock or clay, then was filled with layers of sand, small rocks, and possibly concrete. The climate and the type of soil determined how elaborate the foundation had to be in any given area. Finally, the paving and curbstones that had been cut and shaped by skilled stonemasons were fitted together with great precision. The roads were designed to be a little higher in the middle, so the rainwater would run off to the sides. The fact that this work was done with basic hammers, chisels, picks, and spades makes it clear how much manpower must have been expended. The removal of excess dirt was done in basket loads. The wheelbarrow, already in use in China, was not yet part of European technology. The impressive end result of all this planning and labor did not go unappreciated. The Greek author and philosopher Plutarch had this to say in around 120 BC.
The roads were carried straight across the countryside without deviation, were paved with hewn stones and bolstered underneath with masses of tight-packed sand. Hollows were filled in. Torrents or ravines that cut across the route were bridged. The sides kept parallel and on the same level. All in all, the work presented a vision of smoothness and beauty.
The bridges that were built across the rivers and ravines are further testimony of the engineering skill and advanced building techniques of the Romans. One method the Romans employed on some of the larger bridges over water was to use a series of barges to create an initial foundation and work platform. Early on, the Senate was concerned about the reliability of some of the proposed bridges. In the case of the Ponte Fabricio, payment was withheld for 40 years to make sure of its durability. The Senate's concerns turned out to be unwarranted. The Ponte Fabricio is still in use today, some 2,000 years after it first spanned the Tiber. Historians are not fully certain when the Romans decided to traverse the Alps, but it was probably motivated by their determination to subdue the Gauls. Three roads had been built to the base of the Alps: the St. Bernard Pass, 8,111 feet above sea level, was chosen as the place to cross. It was decided that the environment might be too cold for slaves, so soldiers did the work. Once completed, the snowfall was often so heavy during Roman winters that the pass was closed from November to April. At the highest point in the pass, a temple was built, along with a rest station that also housed men assigned to rescue travelers lost in the snow. Road building in the different territories of the expanding empire often presented challenges to the construction crews that were formidable, but never insurmountable. For example, construction in Spain was problematic. It was mountainous, suffered from bad weather, and was infested with bandits. But Spain's wealth of raw materials and precious metals made it worth the effort. According to Plutarch, the decision to mark all the main roads with milestones was made around 120 BC. The Roman mile was based on 1,000 military paces, which comes to around 4,800 feet, a little shorter than today's mile. The milestone was made to have an average height of about 7 feet and weighed around 1,000 pounds. The information carved into it usually included the name of the road, the mileage, and the name of the emperor in whose reign the road was built or renovated. One reason for the decision to place milestones along the roads may have been to create a public works program. Slaves had taken work away from the underclass, and unemployment and crime were becoming problems in Rome. Thousands of milestones were quarried, carved, and hauled all over the empire.
In a sense, of course, it's not that all roads lead to Rome. It's that all these roads lead from Rome. Roads led from Rome in order to control Rome's empire. And the golden milestone, which was erected by the Emperor Augustus in 20 BC, was a great, huge, in fact, not made out of gold at all, but marble milestone with the distances in bronze plaques to the great cities of the empire from that spot. It was just under the Temple of Saturn.
Part of the reason that Augustus chose this part of the city, and particularly this part of the Forum, to erect the milestone was that it's the political center of the Forum. This was the part of the Forum where the Senate negotiated decisions of war and peace, where all the laws were made and passed. And so it made sense in that way to have the center of the Roman world be there. But in a sense, it's metaphorical. The roads don't really converge in the center of Rome. They converge only at the gates, so they converge at the wall. But for Augustus, Rome had become a capital city of an empire, and he needed for his political agenda a physical center, a metaphorical center.
We will never know exactly what was inscribed on the golden milestone. It disappeared shortly after the fall of the empire, probably ravaged for its bronze plaques, which could be removed and melted down. Roman roads were often dedicated and named in honor of the powerful emperors of Rome. Even though they were important militarily, they were built for everybody to use.
Ordinary people used the roads, like the rest of us, for religious purposes, seeing temples, visiting oracles, going to Athens for a bit of education. But, of course, the way that the roads penetrated furthest into ordinary people's lives were that they brought products from all over the empire to Rome. The roads connected Rome to India and the spice trade. And the grain that went into the bread that people ate wasn't grown next door. It came by sea from Africa and Egypt, but then up the roads to Rome. There's a customs tariff from Africa, which shows all the things that traveled along these roads, everything from fish paste, garum, to slaves coming up from the Sahara Desert, to horses, mules, animals, cloth, purple dye. Anything that you could buy was likely to have traveled along one of the great roads.
At its peak, Rome had over 1 million citizens, and it had to be constantly supplied by the local farmers. On an average day in the first century AD, chariots here would have been a much rarer sight than farmers taking their goods to market. The curious thing is that with all the effort in building and maintaining a magnificent road system, it was not the best way to transport bulk goods. The Romans never perfected a type of harness that enabled horses to pull heavy carts or wagons. They were originally designed for slow-moving oxen and would press on a horse's windpipe when pulling a heavy load or going uphill. Of course, when possible, the more practical way to transport goods was by water. Boats were often much faster, thus much less expensive. It was only the Romans' fear and suspicion of the sea that kept shipping from becoming the main method of transport to far-off destinations. One of the most interesting commodities being shipped along the roads was the astounding menagerie of wild animals then being captured all over the Roman world. Some became pets or parts of collections of the rich and powerful. A majority of these exotic species ended up in the spectacles being staged at the Roman amphitheaters. Sometimes, hunts would be reenacted. Often, different species would be pitted against each other. Many times, it was man against beast in a battle to the death. The death penalty for criminals was often carried out by ravenous animals for the entertainment of the spectators. Christians suffered the same fate during the period of the great persecutions. The Emperor Claudius had a division of Praetorian guards battle panthers. During Nero's reign, 400 tigers faced off against bulls and elephants in one day. 5,000 animals lost their lives as part of the Colosseum's opening ceremonies. The streets of Rome are prone to traffic jams today, and the same was true during the height of the empire's success. Noisy crowds combined with the deafening sound of wooden wheels clattering over pavement stones. More than once, laws were passed forbidding, or at least limiting, daytime traffic within the city. After the disastrous rule of Nero and the three emperors that came and went within a year, Vespasian's 10-year rule helped reorganize an empire in disarray. New roads were built in Asia and Spain. He then commissioned the overseer of the roads to make a survey of the entire highway system, from which many maps called itinerarii were made. A specific itinerarium would show the route between cities, mileage, rest stops, and other details helpful to travelers.
The most interesting is the Poitinger table. It's a medieval copy of a much earlier Roman map, and it's called the Poitinger table because it was acquired by Conrad Poitinger in 1508. It's now preserved in Vienna. And it's an extremely interesting map, because when you first look at it, it doesn't look like anything we recognize as a map. And what it is it's a graphic picture of routes. It's how to get from A to B in a very abstract way. The best parallel are maps of subway systems. It gives us straight lines running, say, from Carthage to the great legionary fortress at Lambyses, with along it marked all the stops that are possible along the way, so that it was like a guidebook.
A common sight along the roads just outside of Rome was the funeral procession. Funerals were grand occasions for the wealthier families. Professional mourners filled out some of the processions. Actors wearing death masks would portray ancestral family members. The body of the deceased was placed on a bed or a couch-like litter. Candles and torches often were burning at each corner. Pine cones and incense were also burned, possibly to hide the odor of the corpse that usually had laid in state at home for up to a week. Early on, most of the funerals were cremations. Later, interment became more popular. For the elite, size of funerals and tombs clearly became a case of status-seeking one-upsmanship. But such competition was considered inappropriate, and laws were passed to restrict the number of professional mourners allowed in a procession. Family members would visit their interment sites. Pagan Romans believed that the recently deceased still needed to be nourished with food and drink. But the most impressive spectacles to happen on the roads of Rome were grand processions called triumphs.
When a general concluded a major war and came back to the city of Rome with his army, he would wait outside the sacred boundary of the city, the Pomerium, and he would get permission from the Senate to enter the city. And when he did, he did it with his entire army, with all the prisoners he took in the war, with all the spoils, and they would follow a certain prescribed route through the Campus Martius, starting at the Circus Flaminius, through the Circus Maximus, and then they would come down the Sacra Via, through the Forum, and then up onto the Capitoline Hill to the Temple of Jupiter.
These grand processions took on truly epic proportions. There would be trumpeters, and sometimes there would be floats representing captured cities. Mounted artwork would show scenes of the battles and heroic exploits of the returning heroes. Julius Caesar had one after each of his major conquests, each more lavish than the last. His final triumph lasted for 4 days. It would have seemed absolutely impossible to cheering throngs filled with imperial pride that assassination and civil war were just around the corner. Common language and currency throughout the empire made travel on the roads easy in some ways, but actually to journey any distance on them made for a long and arduous trip.
Traveling along roads would have been uncomfortable whoever you were, but I think the more money you had, the less uncomfortable it was. If we drive along the Appia today with modern suspension, it's still a very bumpy road. And so traveling in a carriage with no springs would have been pure hell. I think most people preferred to walk. A horse would have been a horse. But the emperors preferred to travel generally on litters. Those are sort of beds on poles, open if they wanted to show off, closed if they wanted to sleep. And they would have been carried by 8 bearers, and it would have been slow. But it would have been, I suppose, the most comfortable way of traveling of all.
Inns sprang up all over the main highways because overnight stopovers were usually required on anything but the shortest trips.
The inn by the side of the road would be where there was good water. It might be the simplest, crudest imaginable place with bad wine. The next step up would be a place with better cuisine, better wine, girls for rent, for example, it's very commonly spoken of. And some places, of course, were more elaborate, and these would be the mansiones, the mansions where government officials could stay overnight. You took your chances on the road. It was rough, it could be dangerous, and the kinds of accommodations one got were very iffy in many cases.
Though many inns were raw and Spartan, they were often the beginnings of a settlement. They would begin to grow with the additions of blacksmiths, wine merchants, horse doctors, and others offering service for passing travelers. Many of the great cities of Europe, like Vienna, Cologne, and Budapest, began as lowly stops on a Roman road. From his writings, we know that the great Roman poet Horace spent time on the roads. He had traveled on the Via Appia as a boy with his father to study with a learned Greek grammarian. As an adult, he also used the Appia and gives us an idea what travel was like back then in these excerpts from his satire titled From Rome to Brindisi with Stops.
'Twas a long journey lay before us. First at Aricia, we alight and there refresh and pass the night. Our entertainment? Rather coarse, but believe me, I've met with worse. From Aricia, we pushed on to Forum Appii, a place jammed with boatmen and sharp innkeepers. This 40 miles took us 2 days, while brisker travelers make it in one. At Forum Appii, I found the water so foul, I sturdily resolved to pronounce a fast, and in a moody humor wait, while my less dainty comrades ate.
Later, Horace tells of a stop at a farmhouse in the country and reveals a bawdier appetite, often celebrated in Roman literature and performance.
Here, like a fool, I was tricked by a girl who said she'd come and retire. I waited till midnight, but then sleep overcame my desire. Filled with pique at her cheek of such a flagrant nocturnal omission, I then contented myself with dreams composed of improper positions.
Horace describes other travails like traffic jams and mosquitoes, but bad food seemed to be his main complaint. At one point on his journey, he offered a piece of advice.
From hence in chaises we were carried 24 miles to town with many a sign. Their bread is deemed such a dainty fare, that every prudent traveler loads with many crusts. For at Canisium, you might as well attempt to gnaw on a stone as to try and get just one morsel down.
Some emperors spent a great deal of time on the road. Claudius had a specially designed carriage that allowed him to indulge his passion for gambling. But it was Hadrian who spent more than half of his 21-year reign traveling to many of the farthest reaches of the empire. Hadrian suffered a tragedy during his travels. His young male companion, Antinous, drowned in the Nile. Hadrian paid homage to him by building an Egyptian city in his name. During the reign of Hadrian, the last of the great road-building emperors, the Roman Empire reached its widest boundaries. It was an age of peace and prosperity. It was a high point that had nowhere to go but into a decline that would bring the roads and the empire itself to a crashing fall. The Roman road system was designed to help the empire prosper, but the roads turned out to be a military liability as well as the asset they were originally meant to be.
It was convenient for barbarians to find their route paved out straight to Rome. It became particularly so in the later empire when the Goths would come down the Via Aurelia or Via Flaminia to Rome. But Hannibal, much earlier on, used the Via Latina for a lot of his activity in Italy. It was a two-way street road.
In 218 BC, during the Second Punic War, the Carthaginian general Hannibal left Spain on his prolonged siege against Rome. He led the first large army over the Alps into Italy, and for the next 15 years successfully waged war against every Roman legion sent to defeat him. Hannibal left a path of destroyed cities and bridges and a huge Roman death toll. Roman manpower was so consumed in warfare that no new Roman roads were built during this period. But road maintenance remained a priority. They had become economic and supply lifelines that had to be kept open. After 25 years of warfare, Rome had lost 500,000 men in battle. It was then Publius Scipio's turn to take command. He decided to no longer fight a defensive war and took the risk of striking at Carthage itself. In 204 BC, Scipio and an army of 25,000 men landed near Carthage. Hearing of the invasion, Hannibal headed back to North Africa. The Roman legions were far more skillful than Hannibal's war machine. Hannibal's army was soon outflanked. Victorious, Scipio took Hannibal's mother's name and became Scipio Africanus. Usually, after a victory, Roman roads would soon follow. But it was felt that Carthage was still dangerous. It wasn't until much later, when the city was literally leveled and then rebuilt under Roman rule, that it would have the advantage of being part of the great highway system. Not all resistance came from those fighting to keep from being absorbed into the empire. Sometimes rebellion came from within, from those tired of living under oppression.
The most famous of several slave revolts in the Roman world took place just before the establishment of the empire, in the 70s of the century before the Christian era, and led by a slave named Spartacus, who seems to have been both intelligent and humane. He rapidly gained many followers when he started this revolt, and he and his followers moved from southern Italy all the way up to northern Italy, to the Alps, but his followers wouldn't go any further. They wanted to plunder.
Spartacus used the roads to his advantage during the rebellion, but they also aided the legions dispatched to crush the insurrection. Finally, after Spartacus was cornered, the roads became the setting for the horrible punishment that he and his followers suffered at the hands of their oppressors. 6,000 slaves were crucified along the roadside as a graphic example of the terrible consequences of defiance. There was one revolution that almighty Rome was unable to suppress. It was a revolution of ideas in the form of a new religion, Christianity. The roads played an important part in Rome's attempts to stamp it out. But even under the constant threat of persecution and death by the empire, the followers of Jesus used the pagan highways to spread the words of their leader.
The most famous of all, of course, is St. Peter, who, having chosen to leave Rome to avoid a certain fate in the first great persecution, is said to have met Christ on the Appia just outside of Rome and
walk the ancient paths of glory, avenues of bloody conquest which ensnared the world in a web of power and turned an insignificant city into ruler over most of the known world. Road building is one of the great indicators of a successful civilization. A society must have long-term success to invest the time, manpower, and money to build an infrastructure designed to last. It's not that the Romans were the first to build highways and byways of any significance. The Greeks and the Persians did, and so did the Etruscans, the civilization that predates the Romans in Italy. But no one before them had built with the long-term planning, precision, and scope of those the Roman Empire left behind. The first great Roman roads were begun in the 4th century BC. They were still building them in the far reaches of the empire as late as the 4th century AD. So in total, Roman road building stretched over 8 centuries. The major objective was to ensure that no major point anywhere in the empire was isolated.
So the road system developed with major arteries running from major towns on 3 continents, Europe, the Near East, that is Asia, and North Africa. Not all of these were paved. Popular conception is that they were paved with stone. The lesser ones would tend to be tracks, but kept up, that is to say, raked over or whatever. The technical word is metalled, that is, they'd have gravel and crushed stone on them. The main roads would be blocks of stone carefully fitted together and very carefully built.
It is generally accepted that the first of the great paved Roman highways to be built was the Via Appia.
Here is one of the relatively well-preserved segments of the Via Appia Antica. The name Appia comes from the name of the censor, Appius Claudius Caecus, Appius Claudius the Blind, who built the thing, or started the thing, in 312 BC. The road was the first one to extend the Roman road system really outside of the area immediately around the city. The ultimate aim of the road was to take Roman troops from here down to the ancient city of Capua near the modern city of Naples.
Appius had convinced the Senate this project warranted their approval. He then oversaw the massive undertaking of building a thoroughfare to Capua, the place where the Roman legions had recently defeated the Samnites, a distance of 132 miles. The paving stones were quarried from a deposit of silex lava. They were cut, shaped, polished, and fitted so closely together that a knife blade often couldn't fit in between them. The roadbed was 15 feet across and only widened near the gates of the city to accommodate more pedestrian traffic. As sections were completed, Appius had trees planted along the route to give shade to the travelers soon to come. Gently rolling land just south of Rome made the first several miles of construction easy. Then it had to pass through the swampy lowlands known as the Pontine Marshes. Construction literally bogged down as malaria plagued the work crews as they built a 6-foot-high causeway above the flatlands so the Appia would stay high and dry. Where the water got too deep, a short boat ride became necessary. It was several hundred years later, during the reign of the Emperor Trajan, that the marshes were partially drained and travel on the Appia was no longer interrupted. As construction continued, Appius lost his sight and became known as Appius the Blind. Legend has it that Appius continued to oversee the building and care of his road. He would walk along the Appia barefoot and was able to feel the joints of the stones with his feet to determine if they'd been correctly fitted and maintained. Appius died before his magnificent via made it all the way to Capua. His family built a large tomb along the road that bore his name. This was the beginning of another trend. Over the years, many miles of the Appia became crowded with cemeteries, tombs, and other funerary structures. It was law and tradition to bury the dead outside the city, in places that people would travel. It was not only a tribute, but also a reminder to all who passed by that they too were mortal. The Appian Way was the only road of its kind for some time. It was later extended to the port of Brindisi on the east coast of Italy and had a total length of 350 miles. During this time, other great roads began to radiate out from Rome and lace the Italian peninsula. They also began to spread across most of the known world. It wasn't too long before, at the height of the empire, all roads would indeed seem to lead to Rome. Roads were essential to all governmental and cultural enterprises. And the Roman Empire, being vast, required an extensive road system. As with modern cultures, most of the cost of building infrastructure was paid for out of revenues collected as taxes and tariffs. Most of the emperors understood just how critical these avenues of transportation and communication were. Some, like the first emperor, Augustus, actually contributed significant portions of their personal fortunes to road construction or refurbishment. They encouraged other rich men to do so as well. Since the roads themselves were deemed important to the empire, to be in charge of their repair and administration was considered an esteemed position. The Roman road system was divided up into several districts. Each district had a curator who was responsible for the maintenance in his area.
This meant the obvious, which is, of course, replacing loose stones with great care to drainage and the like. Make sure the milestones are not carted off to build somebody's house. To keep the curbs, which were built on the best roads, in line. Those get battered by animals, carriage wheels, and all these things had to be taken care of. And, of course, if there was an earthquake, and there's a great line of earthquakes, as we all know, that runs right across Turkey, Greece, Yugoslavia, and into Italy and beyond. If there was a great flood or natural disaster, the curator of that section had his work cut out for him because the roads had to be kept in repair.
Julius Caesar's rise to power began because of the praise he received while he held the position of overseer for the Appian Way. Later, as a general and then the ruler of Rome, the roads served him well. Most of the main roads throughout the empire were started for military purposes. As more and more territory came under Roman rule, they became critical lines of communications for news and orders. They greatly increased the speed of armies dispatched to any trouble spot within the empire, or to the fortifications built along its frontiers. When traveling, the legions would usually march six abreast. One can only imagine what an imposing sight the mobile Roman army must have been. All civilian traffic obviously gave them the right of way. Besides the throngs of infantry, there might be mounted horses. Huge weapons of war, including catapults and battering rams pulled on wooden wheeled carts, added to what must have been a thundering rumble. Food, water, and other supplies would also accompany an army on the move. At the end of each day, they would build an encampment to spend the night. Often these encampments would be turned into outposts to house a small number of soldiers. Their responsibilities included policing the area to keep highwaymen and brigands from preying on passing travelers. In the eyes of some emperors, the building of the roads served a purpose beyond the obvious military and economic ones. Public works construction kept the army busy between wars. Busy hands are happy hands, and idleness is the devil's playground are two axioms that the rulers of Rome would have understood well. Digging ditches, laying paving, and building other Roman infrastructure would hopefully keep the questioning of authority and rebellion to a minimum. While the army did provide almost all of the manual labor for road construction outside of Italy, closer to Rome, civilian, criminal, and slave labor did much of the backbreaking work.
The degree to which slaves were used in making roads is very difficult to determine. Road administration was in the hands of men known as curatores, curators. And they varied in their authority and the district which they were in charge of. And they would be allowed to hire slave gangs, freedmen and the like, and ordinary citizens to work. It's awfully difficult unless we have a description in, say, a written passage of literature or an inscription to say anything about this. But we do know that free people and slaves often worked side by side. And the government owned slave gangs in Rome that may have in other places. Slavery diminished as the empire's life was prolonged. No new conquests, no new slaves.
Rome was filled with skilled architects, engineers, and surveyors who helped plan and build the great structures we associate with the Roman Empire. The building of a road was planned and executed with the same care and effort that went into the Colosseums, arches, and aqueducts. In Roman times, a surveyor had relatively simple instruments to work with. The compass had not yet been invented, so a sundial was used to determine direction. A groma was a device made up of two perpendicular sticks with hanging plumb bobs on the top of a staff. It helped lay out straight and level routes. Actual construction usually began with the digging of ditches on both sides of the planned road to drain away any excess water. Preparation of a foundation was the innovative step that set Roman highway building apart from anything attempted before. A trench was dug down to a layer of rock or clay, then was filled with layers of sand, small rocks, and possibly concrete. The climate and the type of soil determined how elaborate the foundation had to be in any given area. Finally, the paving and curbstones that had been cut and shaped by skilled stonemasons were fitted together with great precision. The roads were designed to be a little higher in the middle, so the rainwater would run off to the sides. The fact that this work was done with basic hammers, chisels, picks, and spades makes it clear how much manpower must have been expended. The removal of excess dirt was done in basket loads. The wheelbarrow, already in use in China, was not yet part of European technology. The impressive end result of all this planning and labor did not go unappreciated. The Greek author and philosopher Plutarch had this to say in around 120 BC.
The roads were carried straight across the countryside without deviation, were paved with hewn stones and bolstered underneath with masses of tight-packed sand. Hollows were filled in, Torrents or ravines that cut across the route were bridged. The sides kept parallel and on the same level. All in all, the work presented a vision of smoothness and beauty.
The bridges that were built across the rivers and ravines are further testimony of the engineering skill and advanced building techniques of the Romans. One method the Romans employed on some of the larger bridges over water was to use a series of barges to create an initial foundation and work platform. Early on, the Senate was concerned about the reliability of some of the proposed bridges. In the case of the Ponte Fabricio, payment was withheld for 40 years to make sure of its durability. The Senate's concerns turned out to be unwarranted. The Ponte Fabricio is still in use today, some 2,000 years after it first spanned the Tiber. Historians are not fully certain when the Romans decided to traverse the Alps, but it was probably motivated by their determination to subdue the Gauls. Three roads had been built to the base of the Alps: the St. Bernard Pass, 8,111 feet above sea level, was chosen as the place to cross. It was decided that the environment might be too cold for slaves, so soldiers did the work. Once completed, the snowfall was often so heavy during Roman winters that the pass was closed from November to April. At the highest point in the pass, a temple was built, along with a rest station that also housed men assigned to rescue travelers lost in the snow. Road building in the different territories of the expanding empire often presented challenges to the construction crews that were formidable, but never insurmountable. For example, construction in Spain was problematic. It was mountainous, suffered from bad weather, and was infested with bandits. But Spain's wealth of raw materials and precious metals made it worth the effort. According to Plutarch, the decision to mark all the main roads with milestones was made around 120 BC. The Roman mile was based on 1,000 military paces, which comes to around 4,800 feet, a little shorter than today's mile. The milestone was made to have an average height of about 7 feet and weighed around 1,000 pounds. The information carved into it usually included the name of the road, the mileage, and the name of the emperor in whose reign the road was built or renovated. One reason for the decision to place milestones along the roads may have been to create a public works program. Slaves had taken work away from the underclass, and unemployment and crime were becoming problems in Rome. Thousands of milestones were quarried, carved, and hauled all over the empire.
In a sense, of course, it's not that all roads lead to Rome, it's that all these roads lead from Rome. Roads led from Rome in order to control Rome's empire. And the golden milestone, which was erected by the Emperor Augustus in 20 BC, was a great, huge, in fact, not made out of gold at all, but marble milestone with the distances in bronze plaques to the great cities of the empire from that spot. It was just under the Temple of Saturn.
Part of the reason that Augustus chose this part of the city, and particularly this part of the Forum, to erect the milestone was that it's the political center of the Forum. This was the part of the Forum where the Senate negotiated decisions of war and peace, where all the laws were made and passed. And so it made sense in that way to have the center of the Roman world be there. But in a sense, it's metaphorical. The roads don't really converge in the center of Rome. They converge only at the gates, so they converge at the wall. But for Augustus, Rome had become a capital city of an empire, and he needed for his political agenda a physical center, a metaphorical center.
We will never know exactly what was inscribed on the golden milestone. It disappeared shortly after the fall of the empire, probably ravaged for its bronze plaques, which could be removed and melted down. Roman roads were often dedicated and named in honor of the powerful emperors of Rome. Even though they were important militarily, they were built for everybody to use.
Ordinary people used the roads, like the rest of us, for religious purposes, seeing temples, visiting oracles, going to Athens for a bit of education. But, of course, the way that the roads penetrated furthest into ordinary people's lives were that they brought products from all over the empire to Rome. The roads connected Rome to India and the spice trade. And the grain that went into the bread that people ate wasn't grown next door. It came by sea from Africa and Egypt, but then up the roads to Rome. There's a customs tariff from Africa, which shows all the things that traveled along these roads, everything from fish paste, garum, to slaves coming up from the Sahara Desert, to horses, mules, animals, cloth, purple dye. Anything that you could buy was likely to have traveled along one of the great roads.
At its peak, Rome had over 1 million citizens, and it had to be constantly supplied by the local farmers. On an average day in the first century AD, chariots here would have been a much rarer sight than farmers taking their goods to market. The curious thing is that with all the effort in building and maintaining a magnificent road system, it was not the best way to transport bulk goods. The Romans never perfected a type of harness that enabled horses to pull heavy carts or wagons. They were originally designed for slow-moving oxen and would press on a horse's windpipe when pulling a heavy load or going uphill. Of course, when possible, the more practical way to transport goods was by water. Boats were often much faster, thus much less expensive. It was only the Romans' fear and suspicion of the sea that kept shipping from becoming the main method of transport to far-off destinations. One of the most interesting commodities being shipped along the roads was the astounding menagerie of wild animals then being captured all over the Roman world. Some became pets or parts of collections of the rich and powerful. A majority of these exotic species ended up in the spectacles being staged at the Roman amphitheaters. Sometimes, hunts would be reenacted. Often, different species would be pitted against each other. Many times, it was man against beast in a battle to the death. The death penalty for criminals was often carried out by ravenous animals for the entertainment of the spectators. Christians suffered the same fate during the period of the Great Persecutions. The Emperor Claudius had a division of Praetorian Guards battle panthers. During Nero's reign, 400 tigers faced off against bulls and elephants in one day. 5,000 animals lost their lives as part of the Colosseum's opening ceremonies. The streets of Rome are prone to traffic jams today, and the same was true during the height of the empire's success. Noisy crowds combined with the deafening sound of wooden wheels clattering over pavement stones. More than once, laws were passed forbidding, or at least limiting, daytime traffic within the city. After the disastrous rule of Nero and the three emperors that came and went within a year, Vespasian's 10-year rule helped reorganize an empire in disarray. New roads were built in Asia and Spain. He then commissioned the overseer of the roads to make a survey of the entire highway system, from which many maps called itinerarii were made. A specific itinerarium would show the route between cities, mileage, rest stops, and other details helpful to travelers.
The most interesting is the pointer table. It's a medieval copy of a much earlier Roman map And it's called the Poitinger Table because it was acquired by Conrad Poitinger in 1508. It's now preserved in Vienna. And it's an extremely interesting map because when you first look at it, it doesn't look like anything we recognize as a map. And what it is it's a graphic picture of routes. It's how to get from A to B in a very abstract way. The best parallel are maps of subway systems. It gives us straight lines running, say, from Carthage to the great legionary fortress at Lambyses, with along it marked all the stops that are possible along the way, so that it was like a guidebook.
A common sight along the roads just outside of Rome was the funeral procession. Funerals were grand occasions for the wealthier families. Professional mourners filled out some of the processions. Actors wearing death masks would portray ancestral family members. The body of the deceased was placed on a bed or a couch-like litter. Candles and torches often were burning at each corner. Pine cones and incense were also burned, possibly to hide the odor of the corpse that usually had laid in state at home for up to a week. Early on, most of the funerals were cremations. Later, interment became more popular. For the elite, size of funerals and tombs clearly became a case of status-seeking one-upsmanship. But such competition was considered inappropriate, and laws were passed to restrict the number of professional mourners allowed in a procession. Family members would visit their interment sites. Pagan Romans believed that the recently deceased still needed to be nourished with food and drink. But the most impressive spectacles to happen on the roads of Rome were grand processions called triumphs.
When a general concluded a major war and came back to the city of Rome with his army, he would wait outside the sacred boundary of the city, the Pomerium, and he would get permission from the Senate to enter the city. And when he did it with his entire army, with all the prisoners he took in the war, with all the spoils, and they would follow a certain prescribed route through the Campus Martius, starting at the Circus Flaminius, through the Circus Maximus, and then they would come down the Sacra Via, through the Forum, and then up onto the Capitoline Hill to the Temple of Jupiter.
These grand processions took on truly epic proportions. There would be trumpeters, and sometimes there would be floats representing captured cities. Mounted artwork would show scenes of the battles and heroic exploits of the returning heroes. Julius Caesar had one after each of his major conquests, each more lavish than the last. His final triumph lasted for 4 days. It would have seemed absolutely impossible to cheering throngs filled with imperial pride that assassination and civil war were just around the corner. Common language and currency throughout the empire made travel on the roads easy in some ways, but actually to journey any distance on them made for a long and arduous trip.
Traveling along roads would have been uncomfortable whoever you were, but I think the more money you had, the less uncomfortable it was. If we drive along the Appia today with modern suspension, it's still a very bumpy road. And so traveling in a carriage with no springs would have been pure hell. I think most people preferred to walk. A horse would have been a horse, but the emperors preferred to travel generally on litters. Those are sort of beds on poles, open if they wanted to show off, closed if they wanted to sleep. And they would have been carried by 8 bearers, and it would have been slow, but it would have been, I suppose, the most comfortable way of traveling of all.
Inns sprang up all over the main highways because overnight stopovers were usually required on anything but the shortest trips.
The inn by the side of the road would be where there was good water. It might be the simplest, crudest imaginable place with bad wine. The next step up would be a place with better cuisine, better wine, girls for rent, for example, it's very commonly spoken of. And some places, of course, were more elaborate, and these would be the mansiones, the mansions where government officials could stay overnight. You took your chances on the road. It was rough, it could be dangerous, and the kinds of accommodations one got were very iffy in many cases.
Though many inns were raw and Spartan, they were often the beginnings of a settlement. They would begin to grow with the additions of blacksmiths, wine merchants, horse doctors, and others offering service for passing travelers. Many of the great cities of Europe, like Vienna, Cologne, and Budapest, began as lowly stops on a Roman road. From his writings, we know that the great Roman poet Horace spent time on the roads. He had traveled on the Via Appia as a boy with his father to study with a learned Greek grammarian. As an adult, he also used the Appia and gives us an idea what travel was like back then in these excerpts from his satire titled From Rome to Brindisi with Stops.
"'Twas a long journey lay before us. First at Aricia, we alight and there refresh and pass the night. Our entertainment? Rather coarse, but believe me, I've met with worse. From Aricia, we pushed on to Forum Appii, a place jammed with boatmen and sharp innkeepers. This 40 miles took us 2 days, while brisker travelers make it in one. At Forum Appii, I found the water so